Hello everyone, my name is Jules Prime, and today I'll be starting a brand new series called Sonic Adaptations. Now in this brand new series, I'll be comparing Sonic Adaptations to the original source material to see how accurate they really are. Now things I won't be covering, or at least things I won't specifically be covering in this video, are various loose adaptations of Sonic 1. Like for instance, I'm not going to reference the brief reference to Sonic 1 in Sonic Super Special 9, where Sonic is running through the Green Hill Zone and even encounters Eggman in his Wrecking Ball machine. I also won't be counting book adaptations like Sonic the Story. Now that doesn't mean I'm excluding books from the series entirely, I do plan on covering the books later on. Since this is the very beginning of the series, I'll only be covering the comic adaptations to keep it a little more simple. Also, it doesn't really matter whether Sonic and Eggman are talking in these adaptations, even though they don't do it in the original game. It's just that it's something they all have in common, and I wouldn't expect a comic not to have it, so I'm not going to take away any points if they have it. But without further ado, let's get into the Sonic the Hedgehog Story comic, volumes 1, 2, and 3. This is actually a very early promotional manga for Sonic the Hedgehog to promote the game. And yes, I know it says comic, but it's actually technically a manga, but that's really besides the point. And on the very first page, you can actually see Eggman's conquest of South Island, and the robots he's using are very humanoid, which is unlike the original Badniks that he uses in Sonic 1. Some of these robots are designed to be construction robots, but other ones are shown with battle gear, so it's worth noting that these robots never actually show up in the game itself. Now the robots begin building his new fortress, and also you can see that Eggman's cape is mistakenly colored red rather than being yellow. His cape being miscolored red is actually very consistent throughout the entire comic, so it's a little more than just a slight mistake. Also, something gimmicky that Eggman does a lot is that he actually always says yes after his sentences. Now, obviously this isn't incorporated into the game because Eggman doesn't talk in Sonic 1, however, this trope never really showed up in any of the games, and is pretty much exclusive to this manga. Now we see this little robot approaching Eggman, telling about the whereabouts of the Chaos Emerald, which is why he came here. Which is, of course, just like the original game. Eggman gathers up his robots and starts to begin the search for the Chaos Emerald. And it's here where we see Eggman's true motivations. He wants to use the Chaos Emerald's power to boil the world's largest egg. Which is definitely not the plot they were going for in the actual game itself. So this seems to be a really early plot that was pretty much taken out. Also, Eggman's love for eggs was also never really incorporated into the games, at least not to this degree. However, there are other continuities like Adventure Sonic the Hedgehog where they do show Eggman's love for eggs. Now we head over to Sonic as he's performing a concert at South Island. And as you can see, his band members were actually cut characters from the original Sonic the Hedgehog. However, before they get to actually start the performance, Eggman bombards their stage. Afterwards, Eggman is confronted by these Sonic fangirls. They're supposed to be known as Sonic's bodyguards, but they don't do a really good job at bodyguarding. These guys never show up in the game itself, or any of the other future games. However, there's one that does kind of resemble Amy. Sonic easily destroys the enemies and confronts Eggman for the first time. Eggman deploys even more robots, but Sonic makes easy work of them. Afterwards, Eggman brings out the Wrecking Ball, which is referencing the first boss fight of Sonic the Hedgehog 1. However, the Wrecking Ball is miscolored to look more like an actual Wrecking Ball. Sonic is able to make easy work of Eggman and is now able to continue this concert. And in this next scene, you can see Eggman trapping the animals in capsules, which is never actually shown in the original game. Which actually brings us to the end of Volume 1 of Sonic the Story comic. Moving on to Volume 2, you can actually see that the Badniks return to their original designs. Despite Sonic being in Marble Zone, there's for some reason Crabmeats and Neutrons despite the fact that they're not supposed to be in this zone. Sonic defeats one of the Caterkillers and saves some of his little animal friends. Afterwards, we get to see these animals being put into the robots, which is something also never shown in the actual game. Afterwards, Sonic sets off to save his friends, and the very first obstacle he encounters are these platforms that go up and down, much like in the original Marble Zone. Also, just like in the original Marble Zone, there's these little balls of fire that jump in and out of the lava. Afterwards, Sonic falls down a pretty deep hole, which is not really like the beginning scene of Marble Zone. Sonic then walks down a hallway and gets chased by a giant wave of lava, which is actually what happens in Act 2 of Marble Zone. Afterwards, we immediately cut to Spring Yard Zone, which is known as Sparkling Zone. And as you can see, Sonic is getting hit around by a bunch of bumpers, which is actually pretty accurate to actually what happens in the stage. Sonic encounters a Crabmeat, which is pretty accurate, however, he also encounters a Neutron, which are not normally found in the zone. Making easy work of them, Sonic makes his way immediately to the Starlight Zone, which is actually known in this comic as the Star Land Zone. There he immediately sees the capsule, which pretty much means he's at the very end of Act 3. You can also see Sonic using the Seesaw gimmick, which is exactly what happens in the stage itself, and even encounters enemies like Orbonauts. And it's here where he confronts Eggman, but for some reason the boss fight is actually changed. The boss is actually the same one as the one that's supposed to be showing up in the Spring Yard Zone, but instead shows up in the Starlight Zone. Sonic destroys the boss and saves a bunch of miscolored animals. Eggman retreats to the Scrap Brain Zone and Sonic is talking with his little animal friends. However, the conversation gets cut off as Sonic is about to go confront Eggman. Now moving on to the final part, which is Volume 3. Now we see this weird turtle base, which seems to resemble the Labyrinth Zone. However, it's also kind of fused with the Scrap Brain Zone for some reason. And in this comic, the Scrap Brain Zone is actually known as the Clockwork Zone. And now you can see these elevators, which only ever show up on the inside of the zone, but are being shown on the outside instead. Sonic makes his way into Scrap Brain Zone, but for some reason ends up in the Labyrinth Zone later on. And here you can see the slide gimmick, which is actually shown in the original Labyrinth Zone. And it's here in the Labyrinth Zone that Sonic encounters Jaws, which is actually an enemy found in the zone. Sonic then encounters Eggman, holding Sonic's friends hostage. This might seemingly be referencing the Labyrinth Zone boss, however the animal friends were never a part of it. Sonic moving so fast actually was able to free his animal friends without Eggman even noticing. Sonic was able to free South Island and all of his little animal friends, which marks the very end of the comic. So overall, this adaptation wasn't very accurate. The plot was a bit different along with some of the events that took place. There was a bunch of strange coloring mistakes, there's characters that were never in the game and also never show up again, a boss showed up out of order, and the zones were also mixed up for some reason. Some of the zones even having different names from the final release. At the very least, they did go through all the zones, even if it was out of order. Now, there were some little details that weren't in the actual game, but I also didn't mind that they added them, like showing Eggman's conquest over the island, or showing the animals being put into robots. If I had to rate how accurate this is to the final game, I would say it's about a 4.8. The next adaptation we'll be looking at is also a promotional comic released to promote the game. This one's just simply known as Sonic the Hedgehog. The adaptation starts with Eggman chasing Sonic in his wrecking ball machine while Sonic's being chased by a horde of badniks. Very weird considering the fact that the boss shows up at the very end of the Green Hill Zone. There's also a Bat Brain, which is not actually supposed to be in this zone as it's supposed to show up in only Marvel Zone. Also, rather than attacking the wrecking ball boss, Sonic seems to have outran it and it fell over. This is us to our next section where Sonic is seen destroying multiple badniks. He also gets to this one breakaway section where he falls into a pit of spikes, which is actually very similar to what happens in Act 3. However, Sonic is thrown one of those swinging platforms, which is found in the Green Hill Zone, but is not shown specifically at this part. Then in the next scene, we actually see the origins of how Sonic and Eggman actually know each other, which is something that never actually showed up in the game, and is not actually something the Sonic lore actually stayed true to. Something to note is that there's 6 green Chaos Emeralds and apparently 1 gray Chaos Emerald. Also, the Chaos Emeralds are shown with a more round shape, unlike in the final game. Also, we see that Sonic isn't originally blue and isn't sporting his iconic sneakers. The sneakers themselves were provided by Robotnik, and as for the blue color scheme, that was when Sonic was running really fast and there ended up being an explosion which caused Sonic to end up being blue, or Cobalt to be more specific. With that brief backstory out of the way, Sonic moves on, and it's here where he's surrounded by not only Robotnik but a bunch of Buzz Bombers and Neutrons. Sonic starts attacking the enemies and then moves on to the very next zone. And rather than being in Marble Hill Zone, Sonic immediately goes to Labyrinth Zone. This could mean that the very brief section we see is actually Marble Zone, but we never get to see any of the background details. Therefore, it looks very similar to Green Hill Zone. Also, for no reason at all, Sonic seems to have skipped the Spring Yard Zone as well. Moving on though, you can see Sonic going down a water slide, which is actually what happens in Labyrinth Zone. Now we see a brief underwater section, which isn't necessarily laid out the way it's supposed to be, but that hardly matters. When Sonic emerges back up water, you can see these little faces shooting out fire. However, not only in the final game do the heads look different, they only shoot out these little small projectiles rather than actual streams of fire. And it's here where Sonic encounters Jaws, which is an actual enemy of the zone, but for some reason he also encounters Choppers, which are not native to the zone. Also, you can see Sonic holding a Chaos Emerald in his hand. This means that Sonic probably went through a special stage that we never actually got to see. Sonic starts swimming upwards out of Labyrinth Zone, which is actually not necessarily what's supposed to happen, because there's actually no sections in Labyrinth Zone that take place outside of Labyrinth Zone. And it's here where he encounters Robotnik and starts chasing him. Now you can see the chase is taking place back in the Labyrinth Zone, which is probably referencing the Act 3 boss fight. However, rather than going upwards, they're going sideways. Just like the actual boss fight, Eggman ends up escaping, and now Sonic is in the Starlight Zone. And you can even see Orbonauts, which are native enemies to the zone. Sonic immediately goes past the Orbonauts, which makes sense since you can't actually hit them in the game itself. At least mostly without taking damage anyways. Sonic makes it to the Scrap Brain Zone part where he's ambushed by Eggman. Now Sonic has to make a choice whether to save his friends or get the Chaos Emerald. Sonic obviously makes the choice to save his friend, and Eggman ends up getting away with the Chaos Emerald. I'd say that this adaptation is a little more accurate than the first one. However, it still does have its fair share of problems. Some zones aren't included, like Marble Zone or Spring Yard Zone. Also, the way some of the zones were portrayed are very inaccurate to how they originally were. Also, the backstory for Sonic and Eggman are actually non-canon to the actual video game lore itself. Also, all the Chaos Emeralds, with the exception of the Gray Chaos Emerald, are all the same color. In the final game, you don't actually get a Chaos Emerald from defeating Robotnik, nor does he take any of them from you during the game. I rate the Sonic adaptation about a 5.2 out of 10. Now to move on to the Sonic 1 adaptation, which was actually told in the Archie Sonic X comics. This one's actually split into 2 parts and is meant to celebrate the 15th anniversary of Sonic the Hedgehog. Unlike the first 2 comics we went over, this one actually isn't a promotional comic for the Sonic 1 video game. That is unless you want to count the Game Boy Advance version of Sonic 1, which was also released for the 15th anniversary of Sonic the Hedgehog. Now in the very beginning, we do have this little filler section, we'll call it. Like before, I'm briefly going to skip over this and get right to the adaptation itself. Though for the sake of context, basically the Chaos get teleported to the human world and immediately get sent back to their world. Later on, Chris is at a soccer game and Sonic doesn't show up. This leads Chris to believe that Sonic was teleported back to his own world, so him and his grandfather start to investigate. Already began to the Sonic 1 adaptation, and it actually already references the very beginning of the zone layout for Sonic Green Hill Zone Act 1. And here at the very beginning of the stage, you can actually see the three rings that are hovering for you to grab. Sonic immediately grabs them, only to find out that they're not the same rings that take place in Sonic X, where grabbing a ring in Sonic X would actually supercharge Sonic. It's then Sonic's hit by a motor bug, which technically came from the wrong direction if we're looking at it like that. And just like in the video game, when Sonic drops his rings, they actually immediately disappear if he doesn't pick them back up. A very nice detail, and I do appreciate it. Now to give proper context as to what's happening here. Basically, Eggman kidnapped Sonic and the Master Emerald and basically put Sonic inside this video game simulation. Which didn't really happen in the original game, but I do also like that this comic does add additional details. That's pretty much the context as to why Sonic's here and why he's unfamiliar with this world, since it's not like his world from the original Sonic X series and it's more like a different world altogether. Meaning in the Sonic X continuity, Sonic may not have stages like Green Hill Zone or rings flying all around the stages like it is in the video games. So I actually do like some of the changes that were made to make it seem more like the Sonic game itself rather than seeming like Sonic's living through it naturally. Sonic also isn't familiar with how monitors work, meaning they're probably not in his world as well. Sonic gets a shield but doesn't react too positively to it. Then we can see Sonic traversing through the spiky bridge, which is also a very accurate detail to the Green Hill Zone. Then we move to the very end of Act 3, which is a boss fight. Also, Sonic can't proceed because there's apparently a force field in the way, which is obviously referencing the fact that you can't leave the boss area until after the boss is defeated. Again, a nice little detail that I like that they added. However, it should also be worth noting that you can actually push against the side of the screen in the original Sonic 1, but it's added just for small detail, I suppose. It's here where Sonic meets Eggman, but he's not acting like himself. He's repeatedly laughing, and that's because the Eggman here is also a fake. Also, according to Eggman, the sprite of Robotnik is actually based off of his grandfather. A weird little detail, but I kind of like it. Sonic defeats the boss and ends up freeing the animals in the capsule. It should also be worth noting that the Flickies don't actually have accurate designs to the original Sonic 1. Also, the animals in this capsule aren't actually accurate to what show up in the actual Green Hill Zone stage. Afterwards, Sonic makes this weird transition into Marble Zone, which I guess can be seen as the loading screen in between acts. Now here you can see Sonic trying to traverse through the dangerous Marble Zone, with fireballs and stuff being shot out of the lava. And when Sonic makes it to the underground section, it's actually not accurate to any of the acts where he goes underground. We do see Sonic fighting Vaporeons, which is very accurate to the zone, dodging fireballs which are being shot out the side, and Sonic even riding the block across lava, which again is also very accurate. And it's here where we encounter Amy, as it turns out that Sonic isn't the only person trapped in the simulation. After Sonic frees Amy, they make it to the very next boss fight section. Also, you can see Amy pushing against a barrier that technically doesn't even exist in the actual game. The boss fight goes exactly how it's supposed to in the actual game, and they end up defeating it fairly easily. After that, they end up heading to the Spring Yard Zone, and when they get there, they actually end up encountering Knuckles. After bumping into him, they fall down a really long ditch, where you can see also these little bumpers that are in the background. Now, there actually is a section that resembles this in Act 2 quite a bit, but that's actually the end of Part 1 of the Sonic X comic adaptation. And now you can see that they have ended up somewhere else in the Spring Yard Zone. The layout of the zone seems pretty simple, so there's not really much to say about it. Now they enter the Spring Yard Zone boss fight, which is of course very accurate to how it appears in the game. At the very end of this act, they actually find Rouge, who is also a part of the simulation. Unlike the other zone transitions, this one actually shows an actual breakaway to the other stage, where before it would show some kind of pixelated transition. They do go to the underwater section of the zone and end up encountering Burrobots, but not only that, they end up encountering Jaws as well. After traversing many obstacles which can be found in the Labyrinth Zone, they end up getting to this part where they get sucked into a tube leading to the boss fight of the zone, which is actually accurately laid out how the boss is supposed to be. They end up making it to the top and now they're at the Starlight Zone. And they even encounter the Seesaw gimmick which can be seen in that zone. However, at the very top, Sonic finds this brick which can be found at Marble Zone. This brick doesn't actually exist in this zone and only exists so Sonic can have all his friends come up there at once. Where if this gimmick were to exist in the actual game, if you were to push it off onto the Seesaw and then go back down there yourself, you wouldn't be able to get back upwards. And now you can see the orbitons of the zone are actually miscolored to be blue and red rather than green and yellow. And it's here where they see Tails encountered up against a fan which doesn't actually seem to be accurate to the game itself. So they don't think there's a fan facing off against the wall directly like that. And now we get to see a brief section of them facing off against the boss fight of Starlight Zone. They defeated the boss and now they're headed off to the Scrap Brain Zone, facing off against many of the obstacles that the zone originally has to offer. In the one section where there are ball hogs, which of course is very accurate to the actual zone itself, now we get to the next section of the Scrap Brain Zone and an obstacle which I'm pretty sure does not exist in the actual game, where Sonic has to use invincibility to get to the other side of a bunch of fire and sparking electricity. And on the very other side, you can see Cream and Vanilla, who are also brought to the simulation. After they find a way to get out, they finally make it to the final boss of the game. However, this is what Eggman wanted to happen. You see, if they defeat the final boss, it'll actually cause the base to explode, sending all of them to the moon. Or at least that's how Eggman describes it. Now, they get very close to defeating the boss, however, before they do so, Chris and his grandfather unplug the Master Emerald, which was powering the simulation. This causes the base to self-destruct, and they have to get out there as fast as possible. And that ends the Sonic X Sonic 1 adaptation. Overall, I think this was actually pretty accurate. A lot of the level design and enemies were there, they went through all the zones, and even fought all the bosses. Sure, a lot of the context was changed as to how they got there, and what would have happened if they defeated the final boss. There was also a bunch of characters who weren't even originally there to begin with. And of course, Sonic wasn't sporting his classic character design, however, in my opinion, I think this is the most accurate adaptation of Sonic 1 so far. They kept true to a lot of parts of the original game, and even changed it up just to make it specifically seem more like it. I'm giving it an 8.8 out of 10. Now moving on to the fourth Sonic adaptation, this one takes place in the Archie continuity. And just like the last one we looked at, this one is also to celebrate the anniversary of Sonic. But where the Sonic X comic was celebrating the 15th anniversary, this one was made to celebrate the 20th anniversary. Now right before we get into the comic, I do like how the cover is actually referencing the American box art for Sonic the Hedgehog. And as you can see, Sonic does sport his modern design. Now the adaptation immediately starts off with Sonic running past a loop-de-loop, which is probably the same loop-de-loop that has the shield monitor on it. Cause in this background, you can see this little slope, which is exactly the lead up to the loop-de-loop where it has the shield on it. Also, the loop-de-loop that we see a little later, if that is the same one that had the shield on it, it would make sense why there's a monitor on it. But moving on with the story, you can see Sonic is ambushed by a bunch of motorbugs. And these motorbugs are actually sporting their same design from Sonic the Hedgehog 4 Episode 1. I'm not really sure why they decided to give him these designs, I guess they want to make it feel a little more modern, while also feeling classic, which I guess could make sense given Sonic's design. Sonic freezes animal friends, and then immediately goes towards a tree and starts riding on a neutron. Not necessarily what happens in the original game, but it's kinda cool to look at regardless. And it's here where we immediately get to the boss of the act, but instead of it being Robotnik, it's actually Snively. However, going back to Sonic Episode 4, Snively seems to have hit the platform similar to how Eggman did in that game. So for some reason, they're really going towards Sonic 4, even though this is, of course, a Sonic 1 adaptation. With Snively now defeated, Sonic opens up the capsule, but instead of the normal animals coming out, Sonic meets the Freedom Fighters. And now for a little context. Basically, Eggman launched something called the Genesis Wave, which restarted all of reality. So basically, everything that previously happened in the Archie continuity was essentially retconned, at least briefly in this story. Therefore, the story of Sonic 1 is technically more accurate, even if the backbone of the story being the Genesis Wave taking place isn't, I don't think that really matters. Heading back towards the story, the gang heads to Marble Zone. And it's here where they encounter Caterkillers, which of course are accurate to the zone, but they also encounter Batbrains, but for some reason they do not have their ears drawn, which I think looks pretty weird. You can also see Buzz Bombers, and Rotor actually uses one of the Buzz Bombers to reprogram it. They end up putting a bird inside of it to help him fight on their side, which is kinda weird but kinda cool at the same time. After they defeat all the Badniks, the environment around them starts to collapse with lava all around them, which I guess could be referencing the platforms where if you step on them they catch on fire. After they get away, they end up encountering the boss fight of the zone, which is actually now Eggman instead of being Snively, which of course is more accurate. And while the boss fight seems like it's going to be the same, they actually end up moving all across the zone, which of course isn't as accurate since you're supposed to be in the same place when fighting the boss. Sonic defeats Robotnik and they end up going deeper into the Marble Zone. However, for some reason they end up going into the Labyrinth Zone, which is kind of weird considering the fact that they entirely skip the Spring Yard Zone, which unfortunately is not the only time that they skip the Spring Yard Zone in a Sonic adaptation. Kinda weird considering the fact that this is a two-part adaptation, so they could have easily incorporated it. That pretty much wraps up part 1 of the comic, and now moving on to part 2, they continue off in the Labyrinth Zone. And it's here you can see various accurate stage elements and designs. For example, you can see the spikes swinging from the ceiling, or those little dragon head things that shoot out fire. However, they're also miscolored gray for some reason. They briefly go into the underwater section and are immediately ambushed by Orbonauts. Now immediately they end up breaking a hole in the wall, which leads into another section, which is actually similar to what happens in Hydro City and not Labyrinth Zone. However, in Labyrinth Zone, there's all these little brief drafts that do carry you along the water. Now they end up going down a really steep water slide. However, it appears that Antoine doesn't make it and ends up falling to his doom. Which, funny enough, just like the other adaptation that skips Spring Yard Zone, this one also has a slide with a seemingly endless pit. I find it kind of funny how they kind of compare to each other. The gang moves on anyways, and now they make it to the Starlight Zone, which we don't actually get to see too much of, but from what we do get to see of it, it seems pretty accurate. The brief pictures we're shown show the fan gimmick, the bomb Badniks on the ceilings, and even those little seesaw things that you need to progress the level. Seeing as how they covered an entire zone in only 2 pages, I don't get why they skipped the Spring Yard Zone. Perhaps they just didn't want to do the same gimmick twice, but I'm not too sure. And now you can see they're in the Scrap Brain Zone, which does carry a lot of similar elements like in the actual stage. They have the fire that's shooting up out of the ground, they also have the electricity that can shock you, and even those little trap doors that you can fall in. They even have the swinging spike ball gimmick. However, the arm is colored, which is kind of weird considering the fact that in Labyrinth Zone they were accurately colored. And now Sonic makes it to the final boss fight, which it looks pretty accurate to how it's normally supposed to be. And just like also in the game, it shoots out these little plasma balls at Sonic. However, this one takes place in a more 3D environment rather than it being in a 2D section, which always felt kind of off since this seems like a boss that's always meant to be in 2D, so when you see it in 3D, it just doesn't seem like it works that well. Now that Sonic made it towards the end of the boss fight, it turns out that Antoine is actually alive, and somehow the water ended up getting rerouted to this machine. But basically now with that little intrusion, Sonic ends up defeating Robotnik. And just like in the actual game, before Eggman gets away, Sonic is able to hit him out of the air. Which is actually something you can do in the actual game itself, so I like that they added it. And that just about wraps up the pre-Genesis Wave Sonic 1 comic adaptation. So they ended up adding characters that weren't originally there to begin with. Matter of fact, the characters aren't even in the video game continuity itself. They also ended up skipping an entire zone. But that's really all the negatives I could really say about it. I still feel like the Sonic X one was a little more accurate since they went through all the zones, and they genuinely made it so it was like the Sonic game one itself. I'm giving this one about an 8.5. I do think it was actually pretty accurate. And now it's time for us to move on to our final Sonic the Hedgehog 1 comic adaptation. That means in terms of official Sonic comic adaptations, this means we have more comics that just tell the story itself rather than promote the game. Not to say that's necessarily a bad thing, but I think it's kind of funny. I find it interesting that through the past 3 anniversaries of Sonic, they released a Sonic 1 comic adaptation. I guess it must have been some kind of Archie comic tradition. It makes me wonder if IDW will actually release one for the 30th anniversary of Sonic the Hedgehog to keep the flow going. Anyways, let's hop into the final Sonic 1 adaptation. Now, unlike the other 4 adaptations, this one immediately starts Sonic at the very end of the game, at Scrap Brain Zone. A little weird seeing as how all other previous comic adaptations started him off in the Green Hill Zone. So I guess this one's trying to change things up a bit. The gimmick seemed to be fitting out pretty accurately, as there's buzzsaws and flamethrowers just like in the original. And I make it to this section where Eggman's being protected by a force field to stop Sonic. However, this time Snively is here, but it doesn't really matter as he doesn't really take anything away from the story. It's just like in the actual game, Eggman hits the button which brings Sonic to a lower level of Scrap Brain Zone. Sonic starts off the zone and already is on the descending platform, just like in the very beginning of the act, and also encounters Burrobots. However, those little lion head things are actually shooting out beams of fire rather than shooting out balls of fire. Now, for some reason, these spike balls on the chain for some reason are miscolored red. Now, I'm not sure why this is a thing, and it's actually kind of something I wondered throughout all these comic adaptations, at least the ones that are supposed to be celebrating an anniversary of Sonic. For example, the ones that are made for the anniversary all seem to have some kind of weird miscoloration in their comic. Now, quality control has gone up over the 15 years of Sonic. I'm not sure why in all these anniversary comics there's always something that's miscolored. Given it's not really the end of the world or anything, but it's always something that I've noticed. But moving on anyway, Sonic ends up encountering an Orbonaut, and rather than hitting a spring itself to get to the top, Sonic climbs his way up there himself to make it to the final boss. However, Eggman's being joined by Snively this time, which funny enough actually doesn't really take away from the boss. Seeing as how in the actual boss fight itself, there's always 2 pistons that get shot up when Eggman shows up. It's kind of funny that they put Snively in one of them, because I feel like it actually works really well. I also like that this little room they're in is actually kind of thin. Sure, Sonic can still stand to the side to avoid getting hit, but I still think it's a nice little detail. As in the previous adaptation, these little pistons were just showing up in really huge 3D sections, so it was extremely easy to dodge. Now the boss fight pretty much proceeds as normal. When Eggman goes back downwards, the plasma ball things end up getting shot out, and basically Sonic has to avoid them. This pretty much just continues until Sonic ends up defeating the boss, to which Eggman and Snively start to escape. However, something they did that I actually really like is that when Eggman and Snively were escaping, rather than hitting Eggman's ship, he actually hits Snively's, which is actually similar to what happens in the game itself where you're allowed to hit Eggman or not. What I like about this is that it's actually kind of both endings in a way, because sure, he hit a ship, which is like what happens with Eggman, but Eggman also ends up getting away unscathed. And now with Eggman defeated, we can actually see Sonic running through all the zones to get back to Green Hill Zone, where after the credits originally play, you only see Sonic running back to Green Hill Zone. You don't get to see him running through the other stages. Also, it ends with Sonic leaving in his plane rather than showing him with all the Chaos Emeralds. And yes, this comic does take place in the good ending, since in the next section of the story, Sonic explains that he had 6 Chaos Emeralds the entire time, which I actually really like since this is the only adaptation where Sonic actually got all 6 Chaos Emeralds and got the good ending, which we can all assume is the canon ending in the video game. And yeah, that's the ending of the final Sonic 1 comic adaptation. The only thing that really sucks is that we didn't get to see Sonic traverse the other zones. They immediately skipped to Scrap Brain Zone, and I didn't really like that. Which is, this comic actually skipped most zones out of all of them. Which is weird, because it's the only one to actually do this. I also really like how they incorporated Snively in the story, as it didn't really add anything extra or something that wasn't necessarily already there. At least not like they did in the previous adaptation, where they actually made him a boss fight for some reason. So for the bit of Scrap Brain Zone we did get to see, I'd say they actually followed it very accurately. But since we only got to see Scrap Brain Zone, this Sonic adaptation gets about a 5. And that just about wraps up this video. Like I said before, my favorite Sonic 1 adaptation is definitely the Sonic X one. I remember it was actually the last one I ended up reading, and I actually ended up enjoying it a lot more than the other ones. And I'd say my least favorite is actually the last one that we looked at. As it only shows off part of the game, it doesn't seem like it changed things up a bit, where the other comics actually made things more interesting. So I hope you guys enjoyed this video, and I hope you guys will support this new series, as I do plan on making a whole bunch of more videos like this in the future. So hopefully you guys are actually looking forward to that. And if you want, let me know what your favorite Sonic 1 adaptation is down below. But until next time, this is Jules Prime, and I'll hopefully see you all in the next video.